Hello, let's get started. Good afternoon. Very honored to share with you our topic, which is the case studies and experience of Kata containers at Cloud Container Service. So a quick introduction of myself. We are from Huawei. I joined Huawei in 2011. Before that, I was also a developer of the internet network, and I also do interactive design. Then I be a member of the SPN product of Huawei's development. These years I joined Huawei Cloud, mostly responsible part of the Huawei cloud products. I am currently the chief architect of Huawei serverless container service of cloud container instance. Now talk about a serverless service. It is just a kind of a response to the last speaker. So you can see from my work experience, I'm actually started to convert to container and failed for quite a few just recent years. I'm still an elementary student in the cloud container instance field, so I hope to communicate more with the seniors here. Contents, three parts. First, Kata Container's introduction. And the second, why Kata? Huawei Cloud serverless service. Why serverless service? Why do we choose Kata? And the third is key cloud instances and some of the decision making process. So, Kata container introduction. I think we can go through it pretty quickly. If you've participated in our morning session, then you should be well informed about Kata containers. So Kata containers, it is runtime security containers. Basically, the idea is a virtual machine in order to achieve the same experience of raw containers while provide load isolation to guarantee security. Quite basic stuff. In 2017, the end of 2017, from internet containers Hyper-Romvi, they do integration, and then the result is the Kata container. And in the previous speakers sessions, I think these are all being introduced. On the right, you can see the containers aisles. The basic architect I got from their official website. So basically, you can see the standard interface, the VM realization, and the communication technologies in the mid layer. So these are pretty basic stuff. So why Huawei choose Kata? So we have to first talk about Huawei CCI Cloud Container Instance Service. So start with this CCI service. This previous speaker mentioned that cloud container service, this trend is a trend that a lot of cloud. So we don't tell the users about the resource pool, about the nodes, but they can still use on the cloud. So because in terms of the ecosystem, we are now doing K8S service. So K8 interface is available for the users, so it's maintenance free and more instance and better experience for the user. Actually, at the beginning of 2018, Huawei is the first to propose idea of a serverless container service. We are the first to propose that idea. So in terms of design, I was just talking to a few colleagues, and in terms of the design, we can realize this. It's not a, it is not a VK based. We directly put K8s and connect the, to, for them to manage the bottom layers of resource pool. So my understanding of VK, so for VK, people have some concerns because VK defines the interface, and vendors have to their, do their own realization. So GitHub, so a lot of there is Huawei realization at the vendor side, but we were concerned is that on the base layer, if there is a lot of if there's a lot of repetitive realization, it will be too costly. So to achieve this serverless platform, basically is we can directly manage the base layers of resource pool. Talking about container platform, also the network storage is inevitable. For this part, for OS platform, of course, we need a strong isolation, not at the runtime layer. So for storage, we connect different cloud storage. And for compatibility, we support over 95% of our, not 100%, over 95%. Because if it's OS platform, if it's not a level of interface, will not be open or available to the users. So for our serverless, it's based on APBS, which is optimized by Huawei. So serverless container platform need to have strong isolation, and for us, there should be three aspects of guarantee. One is runtime guarantee, which means is the core that I wanted to talk about, which is the Kata container. And the next part is, of course, at the network level, it should be also strongly isolated. We have VPC-based network solution. And also objects, user interfaces, you still have sufficient isolation model. So we have MC's level of user verification and isolation. So these are all necessary. So for scenarios and the solutions, in at the beginning of 2018, after we launched it, it's been 1.5 years. And in terms of application of different industries and the scenarios, there are actually quite a few instances. There are even scenarios that are extremely suitable. For example, deep learning of AI. In another meeting, I also shared some of deep learning instances. And also, genre computing, sorry, genetic computing, and also CD, CI, and also, you know, it is serverless. As a functions-based platform, it is very suitable, including we have some users, you know, they thinking about strong security demand, for example, government, financial sectors, it is also suitable for them to use. So based on different scenario, you can see that it's suitable for scenarios that require maintenance-free, rapid deployment, easy to use, strong security isolation. There's actually a lot of scenarios that fit in. So surveillance could be the mainstream trend in the future for cloud container. So this is another topic, Kata containers or hypervisors, which one to choose. So from our history, we know that hypervisor, it was launched by Google by the end of 2018. It was quite an innovative idea. During our development, we also see the ideas of hypervisor, very innovative. We also do testing and benchmarking of Kata container and the hypervisor. Actually, in the morning, there's a speaker also mentioned the hypervisor and benchmarking with Kata container. Without hypervisor, it's a two-layer isolation, so definitely it is better than the original kind of raw containers runtime. But there is also the performance benchmarking, like CPU performance. And Kata and the devices are actually pretty good on CPU performance. But there's one issue about the gvisor is compatibility, because we know that it is a new kernel. Does this kernel support all forms of applications? They only supported a limited number of applications. So the compatibility of the scenario is an issue about gvisor.
This will be slower than the hostess score, so this is one of our concerns.
然后就是网络部分,
and for network
part,
gvisor,
用户带的协议站, 性能也是, 反目前看来,
the user protocol stack performance So now let's look at some
designs
in the serverless platform. For networking, we need strong isolation because this is a cloud service which will require the good networking
performance.
So from the isolation perspective,
实现的功能的完备性来讲呢，我们的网络方案选择的就是
Common networking optimization, we can optimize through the OVS plus EPDK. Through this kind of approach,
we
can achieve the acceleration of network on the Kata
socket.
And also we add the vhost socket to Kata, which will also support the
We have 5 million PPS bandwidth. Another networking. RDMA. There
are two options for RDMA, so you can use the IB engineering construction cost, it is more difficult. So when we use the RDMA, performance is better, but Rocky, the difficulty level is lower, but the performance is not as good as IB.
当然也是一种选择。同时呢， Rocky 因为
For Rocky,
华为的网程线 也有一个
最近推出了一个可以认为是下一代的Rocket方案。Next generation Rocket solution called Fabric. Connection to the container
on the serverless.
We also need to support interfacing with the Kata container, which means in the Kata container, we need to have the corresponding components for this kind of interface.
等等。然后管理面其实就非常简单，肯定熟悉的同学肯定就很清楚，就是我们做ID 的比如 plugin，在 host 上去做 IP 设备的发现，去做 IP 资源的开放，我们在上层的定义好 IP 的接口对象，容易申请的时候就不用就 OK 了。然后稍微提一个额外的话题，然后跟安全容器跟卡塔的关系就不是很大，就是同样在网络上我们要支持网络级别的隔离，所以呢对于 ID 来说呢，我们一定是在申请的时候呢要支持 ID 网络的 partition 的设置，就好像我们在普通以下网络要支持 VPN 的设置或者什么的，但通常现在只是相反，我们要支持 VPN 的设置的一样。
Also we need to support the rich LAN support。
IP 呢就像刚才提到的100G 带宽，实际时速应该是到了100G，可能90多G的样子吧。100G 带宽，真的在2到10年，在真的是一个场景，还是非常好用的。
Especially for the deep learning scenario,
okay.
This is a very good.
下部分呢就是CPU 啊。
For GPU,
听起来 CPU， 没什么说的，就像刚才说的一样，就是我们把 CPU 作为直通设备。通过 WiFiO 接入到卡塔容器里面去，我们在容器里面通过我们做好的这个异构硬件的支持的框架，把驱动导引，把这个 CUDA 导引，然后深度学习的应用就可以直接，方便。罗亚提的事情呢，就是稍微比这个复杂一点的事情呢，就是 NVLink 的连接管理，简单描述啊，就是英伟达用来解决 PCIe 带宽时延问题的一套N 卡的这个卡间传输的一套
方式。
为什么让罗亚提一下这个呢？就是我们可以想象一个场景，就是我们一台服务器八块 GPU， 这是常见的，八块 GPU， 然后每块 GPU 呢上面有一种的连接，不是全连接，所以呢，它不是全连接就涉及到一个问题，至少涉及到两个问题。一个问题就是，我们在调度的时候，我们不希望调度到没有任何进行连接的两个 GPU 导入一个机体，如果一个机体要进行超级移动的话。这是我们调度要考虑的事情，所以至少我们在容器这个层面要做到 NVLink 连接的这个连接父母的上报，我们在调度的时候要做基于连接父母的调度。 OK， 这是第一个问题。第二个问题就是我们在调度完成以后，我们调度到某些 GPU 到一个容器里面去，但是我们不希望这些 GPU 和别的容器的 GPU 之间有 NVLink 连接，所以呢我们要做按需的那个连接中断，这也是我管理面包括软件的配合做的事情。这个连接管理啊。然后呢，下一个问题就是，其实比如还是那些 GDR 是啥呢？其实很简单，就是节点，同一个节点包括不同节点之间 CPU 能直接用 RDMA 去访问显存，这样的话能有更高的节点之间的 CPU 数据传输的效率。同样在深度学习场景，这个也非常有用。GDR 要支持的话呢，其实在其实有几个关键点吧。首先一个关键点呢，就是要植入 RDMA， 那我们首先要肯定要支持 RDMA 网络。就像上面提到的一样，我们用 IP。然后呢，就是我们 GPU 和 IP 设备呢要在一个 PCIe 的位置上。这个就是应该说是我们服务器的设计上的一个约束。硬件的约束。然后呢，就是这个卡塔部分要做的事情。卡塔部分要做的事情呢，其实是比较 tricky 的。我们呢，首先我们要在服务器上把 PCIe Switch 的 GPU、CPU、CPU 的 IP 之间的通路放通。之后呢，我们要改 QMU， 还要改 Dial。我们要把host 上的 GPU 和 IP 的放空间和这个讯息里面的放空间给适分一致。这样的话呢，我们的讯息里面就可以操作了。OK， 这是基本表达 DNA。然后呢？ Then, 再提一下GPU sharing 啊,
and also about the GPU sharing,
之前我也和别的,
for GPU sharing,
有张啊,
I've actually talked to customers and talked to friends in industry, because in certain scenarios, there may be a requirement for GPU sharing, but the reason we don't mention this is we don't mention kind of GPU sharing that actually the technologies for GPU sharing is not appropriate or suitable. For example, it is MDV based GPU sharing, then it does not support a multi-tenancy. If it supports NCAS software, hardware technologies, for example, if it supports grid to do GPU sharing, then NCAS license will be problematic. So if the scenarios require GPU sharing, we can actually use some other form or scale of GPU. For example, we can use T4 or P4 these GPU to do, or we can like in Huawei, we have our own chip 310 to match the scenario. So sometimes you don't need the GPU sharing, and even with the scenarios that you need the GPU sharing, it can be replaced. So it is practical, but it's not necessary. So another example for the test data, it is something we did by the end of last year. Our MODAS, which is Huawei's AI training platform, we on the top bench of Stanford, we became the top one on the deep learning ranking. But MODAS, so with 128 GPU, we can have an acceleration ratio about 80% in common scenarios like the 32K and general imaging scenarios. We can even achieve 96-97 acceleration ratio. This is AI computing with Huawei Ascend chip. Support our own Ascend chip because of a reason well known to each other. So this is the storage part. This is also something I like to mention. For the cloud storage, for EVS, OBS, and SFS, these are all our Huawei Cloud storage, all are supported. We also support the local storage. Two optimization points to mention. One is on the same server node for serverless access. Actually, in between, there's still I/O competition between different containers. So for this part, we do I/O control. We have I/O process control. But this process control is not visible to users, but it is managed through the upper layers of management interface, and also you have interface definition from the runtime layer. For example, on the top layer, we have to define the current limiting, to do a current limiting, and another issue is SPK acceleration, and this is an DPK acceleration similar. So in terms of storage, we also support SPK acceleration, including with the cloud storage acceleration, and we also support local storage acceleration, and also data. So for we can do 1 million IOPS for cloud storage and 0.6 million for local storage.
Okay.
And live migration. Live migration. I think previously I didn't heard other people talking about live migration. Well, actually, it is This is something we've been practiced for quite a long time. A lot of scenarios where we have to discontinue the server or do update, but we cannot manage a live migration or a live patching. We don't want to interrupt the customers' users use deep learning, like as an example. In a lot of scenarios, a mission has to run for many days, and that if we discontinue, then you have to rerun it for another, a few days. So the cost for discontinuous is huge. So we want to achieve container life migration to enable that the users can continue their business without being interrupted. This is a very complicated illustration, but put it simply, so from top Dr. Demon to the bottom runtime kata, so at all levels we have to achieve live corresponding live migration interfaces, and you have to also do check and preparation. You also have to do copies. You have to at the kata level, we have to cache copy, container copy.
We
and also do copy at the destination node. So it's quite a complicated logic. And in a DPD case based internet environment, the break time we can do now is less than 1 second.
Okay.
The break time for the network is shorter than 1 second.
So
we're doing this. The story is we're doing this, but for the user's environment, it is not fully deployed. This is an issue that we want to develop. We want to have a wider deployment of live migration so you can increase the reliabilities for our users. And for this solution, different level, the realization of different levels of interfaces, we also want to talk to the community, to the companies in the same industries to promote live migration. The concerns, there's still a lot of restrictions for live migration. For example, in certain equipment and also for local storage, there could be issues. So there's a lot of restrictions. For example, for heterogeneous devices, there could be an issue.
So
these are all X8S, and also because for reasons that is known to you, so recently we will support ARM-based containers,
maybe,
I think in the upcoming several months. And for ARM, the test result is meeting our expectation. So with the single kernel performance is very close to the single kernel performance, and it is cheaper. And also Kata so they support the, but actually it requires extra work. Like the live migration I mentioned, we want to actually support x86 and ARM because, and that means we have to do extra work to make it compatible.
Okay,
thank you. That's all for my presentation.
Oh,
thank you again.